Baby, get up.
The freaks come out.
My friend Davey was back from Sheffield, and I couldn't wait to see him. I knew he'd have some stories to tell about his revelry in England. Besides, I love Berkeley. It's a year-round place with a million distractions and ways to unwind. It's a place where you can thrive on good food, strong coffee, and every kind of vice.
Well, I know what we're going to be doing tonight, dude. You know what we're going to be doing tonight? We're going to be listening to...
What'd you find there?
Sugar Smack.
There's a vibe for everyone, and you don't have to look hard to find the pulse. I figured if I could find a way to tear Davey from his turntables, we could go chill at Indian Rock, the soul of Berkeley bouldering. Indian Rock and the neighboring Mortar Rock are modest rags. The problems are mostly eliminates, but the vibe is infectious. Pure fun.
You pull up, this is on. You bust this bad pinch.
Whoa, an eliminate at Indian Rock?
Yeah,
I think it's the first one.
What? There's no guide and there never will be. It's the people who make this place special.
Timmy, I got some shoes for you today, if you want.
Dozens of strong climbers have passed through over the years. Hundreds of problems get passed from one generation to the next. And Davey is the perfect tour guide, like a kid in a candy shop.
What the hell, dude? This ain't no fucking peep show, boy.
Bye.
You know, there's not that much to climb around here, so you gotta end up at Indian Rock for the most at some point, especially in the old days before gyms. And we knew how much fun we were having out here. You know, you get out of school, walk up here, and boulder. You know, bouldering's great. Yeah, Nat was super talented, way ahead of his time. Totally embraced bouldering, you know. Of course, we had to go to Yosemite and climb cracks. You know, that was great, but he was way more into bouldering, and he was just so talented and ahead of his time. Like I say, when he did Nat's Traverse, I didn't even look at it, you know, for a year or so. Like, what the hell did he do over there? It wasn't even in my vocabulary to see what the hell he was doing. And so, yeah, Nat had a huge effect. So we were kind of like the new wave, you know. There were a lot of good climbers here before us, like Dale Barr, Vern Clevenger, all kinds of guys. Dave Altman, John Sherman. When he first started coming out, he was pretty lame. He was kind of a pudgy kid in high school. Pretty bad. And he just stuck with it. And now you got the new kids like Dave Freeman and stuff. It's pretty fun. They'll be doing the new problems and then still looking at Jungle Fever, you know, like, oh fuck, when did we do Jungle Fever? Like 77 probably, 78, you know, over 20 years ago. So it's pretty fun, you know, you got new stuff, old stuff, but the old stuff's still really good. It's, you know, Nat's Traverse, it's great. It's such a good problem, it's classic. Total fun. It's like the old days.
The carefree nature of Berkeley bouldering has led to true vision. The rock is scarce, so the locals have had to become creative in unleashing the true climbing potential. Smack dab in the middle of the UC Berkeley campus is one of the raddest bouldering problems ever. The Doe Library Traverse ain't no party trick. Though tried by many, it has only been done by a dedicated few. No climbing shoes, no chalk, and no downward pulling holds are the only rules.
Guys in the 60s first did it, and one guy was a climber, the other guy was a dancer, because I worked right up the hill to come down to my lunch breaks, and worked on the dough for months. It took me 3 months to do that, until I did it once, and then after that, I kept coming down a lot more after that, until I got a high enough percentage for it.
After a hard day of climbing, I'm so thrashed. Only one thing left to do, Tim. Party in Oakland!
Nestled in the Santa Cruz Mountains, among the old-growth redwoods, lies a unique collection of sandstone boulders. Castle Rock State Park offers the modern boulderer a respite from the monotony of crimpers. The sloper is king here. Castle saw its first development as far back as the late 50s, when Doug Robinson first touched stone. Through the next couple of decades, it was the stomping ground of Barry Bates, whose bouldering exploits in the Yosemite Valley were legendary. Recently, Castle Rock has seen a resurgence in activity by a new generation of dedicated boulderers. The newer problems are now among some of the classics. Recently back from Fontainebleau, Jeremy Miggs makes the often-made comparison to that legendary bouldering mecca.
Fontainebleau was absolutely the most beautiful rock I've ever seen. The castle is like a small portion of Fontainebleau. Just a little bubble. Good scenery in the middle of the forest. It usually stays fairly cool, and the slope of palms and mantles are just phenomenal. A lot of times conditions are super dependent at Castle, as far as you need cold, dry weather, and then the slopers stick a lot better. Slopey madness, that's all it is.
After the tour, Jeremy took us to the object of his ambitions. First climbed a few years back by Chris Sharma, the eco-terrorist epitomizes the essence of Castle Rock bouldering, distilled down to just a few holds. A starting undercling Waco on a steep overhanging wall, a slopey lip, a couple of slopey intermediates, and the mother of all jugs marking the finish. Contact strength and ideal conditions are required on this test piece, which still hasn't seen a second ascent.
I think we looked at it like 2 years ago first, and we just heard about it and had seen a picture in a magazine or something of someone on it, and when I looked at it, I didn't believe it. It was just looked too hard. Eco is like the one problem that I actually want to get. It's just kind of my goal. If I do this, I'll be totally happy with climbing forever. Probably almost the hardest move on is matching the lip. the sloper lip there, and my feet always were cutting when I did it. We came back over a number of days, and every day we made a little bit of progress. Figuring out the beta, doing like one step further each time. Finally, I figured out how to do this key little kind of toe hook inside the Waco that you go from. And once I did that, it goes like almost every time I'm just falling at the last move over and over and over again.
Let me rest. Who's going? I'm going right hand again.
Right hand, like bump to the jug?
I'm going right hand again. I'm dropping my right foot out. It was like, it sucks. It's like right there.
Yeah.
I thought you were going to do it, dude.
I thought you were going to do it, too.
I was just like, that was the most solid I'd ever seen you do the first move. You're like. Keep pulling with your right leg when you go with your other hand up. No?
You have to have your foot down.
Okay.
Flat on it. I know that part.
One crisp fall day, it all came together.
As the weather cooled down, everyone's attention focused on the valley. There is something majestic about this place. Its history is a rich tapestry of legends and mystique. It is here that the modern age of bouldering really took off, with Ron Kauk's ascent of Midnight Lightning in 1978. Camp 4 is the crucible for every serious boulderer who wants to test themselves on some of the most famous and demanding lines in the world. I can never help feeling humbled every time I walk into Sunnyside Campground. For most, it's a sobering experience. Bouldering in Camp 4 is not easy. It won't appeal to the faint of heart. The grades are solid, and many problems are off the deck. And the cruxes are seldom near the ground.
We'll be right back. Come fly with me, let's fly away. If you can use some exotic booze, there's a bar in far Bombay. Come fly with me, let's fly away.
As winter approached, we descended upon Bishop, the hub of East Side Bouldering, land of the endless summer. With over 30 areas and 3,000 boulder problems in counting, it has stepped up as America's new winter bouldering mecca. The East Side has just entered its golden age. It is a paradise to be enjoyed and protected. Mick Ryan, a Bishop local, has written many bouldering guidebooks for the area and is well familiar with the history and diversity of bouldering on the East Side. He is also quite active in trying to raise the level of awareness among climbers and preserve access for all.
On the Sierra East Side, bouldering has been going on for like the last 40 or 50 years, starting with probably Smoke Blanchard in the 1940s up in the Buttermilk area. Since that time, there have been waves of development, Dale Bard, and lots of people you've never even heard of. But most of the bouldering has been concentrated in the Buttermilk area, and recently on the Tablelands. So yeah, you've got a good variety of climbing. Not just one type like you have in Fontainebleau, or Gritstone, or Waco. Best thing about it is that you can climb all year long, because this is the land of little rain, and it never rains apart from today, whereas other areas, world-class bouldering areas like Fontainebleau, you've got to put up with the rain, you've got to put up with the French, and you've got to put up with expensive coffee. Waco, you've got to put up with El Paso and the restrictions there. English Gritstone, you've got to put up with the attitude of the British climbers and all the wetness in the winter. So it's probably, in my opinion, the best bouldering area in the world. But don't take my word for it. You've got to come and visit. The biggest concern we've got around here is safeguarding our freedom to climb. Everybody should now be aware of the situation at Waco Tanks, which is climbing at Waco Tanks is heavily restricted for a number of reasons. One of those reasons is the behaviour of climbers. So around the Bishop area, what we're trying to do is educate climbers in what we call semi-primitive recreation. That's basically an extension of the no trace ethic, where when you boulder in an area, you leave as little trace of your presence as possible. But also, the land managers, the BLM and the Forestry Service, don't want to construct any structures or signage, or they want limited vehicle access. Also around here, James Wilson, Wilson Eastside Sports, who runs, which is the local climbing shop, he's heavily involved in educating climbers and building a positive relationship, a partnership, if you will, with the Forestry Service and the BLM.
And we'll put some money in so it'll be accessible.
What he's doing
and
is,
then we'll provide the labour.
In conjunction with myself, he's producing literature which educates climbers. And then we also have a volunteer force of climbers who go out and do trash cleanups. Define user trails, and generally talk to climbers about their responsibilities, about leaving no litter, about not climbing on boulders with rock art, and things like that.
Great. Now we can film my fucking standoff with the fucking chasm of death.
Dude, just do the jump.
Fuck that, and videotape my demise. Dude, you're insane.
Underneath the ground and the sky's gray, I'll be for walk on a winter day. I'll be standing at a wall before the end.
It's the process that matters most in bouldering, even more than the glory of topping out. And big numbers never convey the blissful suffering of a good day of bouldering. There's a story behind every problem.
Oh, cool, Rock.
And then,
oh,
dang it,
there's
a crimp right there.
Come on.
Relax.
Oh, shit! Woo-hoo-hoo.
One storybook problem is the golden child. I made the 45-minute uphill trudge to the Druids one day with Vic Copeland and Dustin Sabo to check out their new problem. What I found was a poetic statement of youth, a short pow-pow face on golden patina, topped by a seemingly endless slab.
This hike is too much in the fucking sun.
Fucking hell.
My back's all sopping wet.
I know, it's soaked.
And we're like a quarter of the way there.
The thing that makes it cool is it's all in good holds.
Yo! This problem's fat! You go, you sit in this shit, yo. You sit, you pull hard, yo. You pull. Then you bust this little Frederick Nicole Sloper. This Frederick Nicole Sloper. You twist in. Get this. This is a good hold. It bites on it. You can crimp it. But it gets greasy, though. You get this. You full-on drop knee. You drop knee, twist in, smack, sabwack! You smack that shit, yo. You smack it like it was your mama's boyfriend, yo. Then you bust that crimp, and then...
The micro-crimp.
Bust to the micro-crimp. Hit that, jump for the side pull, and that's the golden shot. Oh, you piece of shit!
Nice.
that leg press.
One inspiring climber that journeyed to the east side during the winter was Maria Palmer, a SoCal local.
Is that right?
She quietly went about repeating area test pieces and established some of her own. It was always a treat when she and Greg arrived.
Come on. Lock harder, come on. I got you, come on. Come on!
Come on!
Ah! Yeah. Come on, strong.
Let me put on that halt.
Did you see that heinousness?
I'm like, I didn't find it intermediate. I mean, just keep reaching. I mean, I grew up as a rope climber. I grew up in the Northwest, and my first leads were at Smith Rocks on tiny, crimpy face routes. And that's what I was taught about climbing. I like it. I still like it. I just haven't put on a rope for about a year now. But I have to say that with bouldering, not only is it the social atmosphere that attracts me, but it suits my mental approach to climbing better. I come to climbing and I want to do the moves. I want to crank so hard. And it isn't necessarily topping out a boulder or topping out a route or anything like that, but it's just doing the hardest I possibly can. And that's what bouldering is all about. Everybody will tell you that.
Come on, there it is.
All right. Strong, right here.
I've had issues within bouldering because I'm female. Yeah. But that doesn't affect, well, it shouldn't affect the way I climb and the difficulty that I climb. It's hard when you're out there and you go out with a group of a dozen other guys and they're all bouldering in their very testosterone-oriented manner. And I know a lot of women get intimidated. A lot of women just have trouble blending with that, and they go in and they do a problem with entirely different data. They just, I mean, mentally and physically, they just have no connection with that. And it's, for a while, I subscribed to that viewpoint. I thought, you know, I'm a woman. They're doing their guy thing. I'm going to do my woman thing. And that didn't really get me too far, because the guys are like, oh, look, she's climbing, and she's a girl. She's, oh, great, look, she's climbing. And I don't want to be judged, say, well, you're a good climber for a woman. I want to be a good climber. It shouldn't matter whether I'm male or female. I want to climb hard.
Thank you.
for me, doing highballs isn't a big deal. I mean, I'm tiny and I have these big burly spotters underneath me. And like of anybody, I'm going to be protected when I fall off a highball. And so I know a lot of other smaller climbers, they're not as interested in doing it. I'm like, that's what we can do. You take a 200-pound guy, and I'd be afraid if I were him doing highballs, because you're just going to squish the person you land on.
What's wrong? Right here. Come on.
I'm still feeling lonely. Feeling so unholy.
Oh, it's wrong right here.
I think that a lot of women have the capability to climb dynamically, but it's just often easier to stay in the style that you know and that you can do.
Hand up. Move your left hand up. It's good. It's good.
Yeah,
come on.
There you go.
Punch it.
Oh, man. I'm still trying to pinpoint the exact mental state in which I can crank closer to my limit. I have to say I haven't quite figured out what it is.
I don't know if I've ever heard you say, I think that's a hard problem. I don't think I've ever heard you say that.
Sure, I say that. Not very often because I don't see hard problems. I don't get on hard problems.
I know, I haven't done a hard problem.
Yeah.
I'm waiting to.
I've never done a hard problem.
Once I do the buttermilk, I've done it.
Come on.
I first heard about the Tablelands from Byron Shumpert a few years back, right after I moved out here from the Midwest. Byron is a true blue boulderer, and his modesty is punctuated by intensely controlled flurries on the rock.
Are they?
Okay, man, are you ready to go?
I'm ready to go. Now, come on, now crank this motherfucker up.
Nice, come on.
Fuck!
Ow!
Byron is the kind of guy you want spotting you, as he is no stranger to falling himself. He is usually the first to lend a hand, and he has a knack for showing up the moment you need him most. Byron has a rare eye for a killer line. He can often find instant classics in areas that were thought to be tapped out by most. Today, he wanted to show some of his friends his new roof problem, therapy, which has a move that makes you dig deep. Really deep.
Turn.
The SoCal crew wasn't the only devoted group of boulderers on the east side during the winter. The Bishop locals, along with boulderers from all over the state, were hanging out at the Tablelands, where a new renaissance was underway. The pace was furious, and each day brought a slew of new problems. It seemed there were plums to be found everywhere, and there was no end in sight.
Thank you.
These are the selections from Spam Coup. Tranquil Reflections on Lunch and Love by John Nagamichi Cho, Spam Haiku Archive Master. Sensing his need grow, she knelt obediently and opened the spam. Slow down, she whispered, now guiding my trembling hands. Turn the key slowly.
Good sound effects.
Come on, Matt.
I'm gonna try.
If it gets you off things, it's so.
The locals weren't the only ones putting up new problems. The Europeans were trickling in and leaving their mark as well. To date, they have left behind a small but impressive legacy of old classics and new test pieces.
Nice one, man.
I met the Swiss climber Mickey Tresch up at the Druids one day. Watching him climb was inspiring. Over the month or so that I climbed with him, I would get used to watching him dispense with just about every problem he touched. Though Mickey is strong, he is humble and unassuming. He tries to never take life too seriously. Maybe that's why he climbs as hard as he does.
Okay, I'm Denton Calhoun. And these are the chicks I had in my life, in my young life. Check it out. Yeah, that's it.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Break down, baby.
Is it still in there?
Yeah. Here it is.
We'll be right back.
Oh shit.
Bubbles.
Yeah. Come inside.
Oh no.
As the weather started heating up in Bishop, the pace began to slow.
Look out!
Most climbers headed back to their own summer havens, while a few stayed behind. The focus was on the multitude of granite areas as climbers sought refuge from the midday sun. New problems were being discovered in classic areas such as the Buttermilk, and in newer areas such as Heaven and the Druid Stones.
Come on, foot up, yep.
Every move, Steve, you got it.
Get it.
All over it.
Come on, Steve.
Let's go, Steve, come on.
You got it, come on.
Get it, Steve. Go.
Yeah, dig into it. Solid. Do it.
Grab it, Steve.
Yeah! Come on!
Get on it!
Come on, Steve!
Finish it!
Finish it! Finish match it,
Steve!
It. Match it!
You got it!
Yeah!
Yeah!
Go! Yeah! Come on, Steve!
Finish
come
it!
On. Yeah!
Yeah!
Nice!
Yeah.
Nice!
Vic and Dustin, two of the most active boulderers on the east side, were still at it, and took some time to share some of their thoughts.
And then the scene here is so rad. We wake up at 1:30 every day, film odd crap, go hang out at Chat's Bakery, and go bouldering, have this just total, this total enveloping energy that makes you push yourself harder than anything you've ever done. That's what bouldering's pretty much all about anyway. Well, if people think that ethics are dead today, they're wrong, because, I mean, the people that are bouldering now, we're avoiding any kind of chipping. We're cleaning the bare minimum with a toothbrush, and we're tackling crazy high stuff without really thinking about the consequences. Because there's this adventurous vibe when you're out, and
to be done, you know, it's sitting there and it's waiting there, and it's just, you want to go do it.
As winter approaches, once again, the Bishop locals are joined by others in the search for perfect stone. No doubt, hundreds of boulder fields across the Golden State will continue to be discovered and serve as the training grounds for generations to come.
Yeah.